Fortunately for us, we never had a dip down year on year. If I have to narrate the first term, I remember my first year turnover.
How much was that?
16,400 rupees for the whole of a year. Next year it was 1,64,000, 164,000. And the third year it was 320,000. The fourth year it was 640,000. So when you are small, your growth looks big. But then, looking back, we really, I mean, like, put struggle to bring in somehow revenues which would allow you to drive you for some better equipment and better, how do you say, instruments or better choice of materials. So that always drove us. And other thing which happened, 78 we started, 1986, we got chance of first export. I would say thanks to export. The first export, Mangesh, it was only 21,000 and odd rupees consignment for New Zealand. But that gave a big inspiration. Somebody in overseas wants this material. So I got hold of my small team of my workers and said, come on guys, we have an opportunity to prove. And at that time, let me publicly give credit to Crompton Greaves. They were our export concessioners, as we call them. They had confidence to qualify my product, which would meet in overseas markets. This was a big opportunity. So this consignment, when we made, I personally was involved into looking into the things that, you know, if things go right. Everything was done fine, sold, happy. The encouraging thing that happened was, repeat order is always an encouragement, and a certificate of appreciation from the buyer in New Zealand telling Crompton Greaves, this is one of the best packings they have ever received from India. Nobody taught us packing. So if you are focused on your job, you somehow do it, is my understanding.
Many of us, especially young entrepreneurs and many experienced entrepreneurs, are unwilling to get into this manufacturing sector because of fear of union problems or workers' management, ER, whatever you call it.
IR.
Yes. So what was your experience and how you could manage proactively, if I may call it?
If you all, whatever you have heard and what I'm going to say, it may look like that you're telling me you're pulling a fast one. Believe me, no. I'm not pulling a fast one. Workers have been my asset. Workmen have been my asset. In my initial days, there was only one staff member, this guy, purchase, sales, everything. So you have to be out, you have to empower your workers to do the things when you are not at home. If, other thing which I would be able to say on that front of workers is, perhaps my own first 5.5 years of that job, I would consider myself as one of the best workmen in that company. So relation building came to me so easy. There I started questioning any wrong thing being done to workmen to become friends at shop floor level, as we call it. So this perhaps became my strength or my feature or whatever. The first employee of my company. I can share with you. He is still in the company. And every day my lunch partner on the same table.
You should clap for him.
Employees or workers, I would say, many times I was asked question, do you have a union, employee union? Dombivli in those days was a notorious place. Textile company and chemical companies having all red flags. So many times this question would be asked to me and I would say I am the union leader. And I had a theory. Believe me, I would tell my workers, and there would be negotiations always, yes. There would always be sometimes not so comfortable talk. But then my philosophy was to tell workers, hey guys, make sure that you guys take care of me, then only I can take care of you. So this was an interaction between face to face, which has somehow survived until now.
I was inspired by your story about an M80 or some car you...
Oh yes!
And I think our audience yes. will be happy to hear.
There's one more thing. If I think all of us can comfort, you would confirm. Many times, we think that as an entrepreneur, we are owners. Excuse me for using a hard language. In fact, that one guy is the servant and he has to take care of all this. Whatever is left, he gets it. How are you an owner? You are not an owner. You have paid for materials, you have paid for employees, you have paid for your managers, you have paid government taxes. After that, whatever is left, if any, is yours. So, the important thing is, if you de-link yourself, by the way, I hate being called owner. Or in our terminology, there's a term called seth. Seth nahi aaye. Who's the seth? Come on. So in those days, if you keep your requirements under control and you let other expenses take care. So in early days, in the very early days of second year or something, third year, we thought we needed a two-wheeler. So two-wheeler was purchased, M80 in those days, Bajaj. M80, we had this typical tradition of coconut and garland, all our workmen standing and who sits on that scooter, or the, as we call it, that, what was
Scooty,
it called?
Scooty.
Scooty or something. Something of that sort.
Moped.
So, who sits on that? My sales guy. Not me. It was needed for him, not for me. So, he would go on a two-wheeler, I would walk to the bus. If you are able to understand this aspect, then I guess things are easy.
Hats off. I also learned from you that your participation in foreign exhibitions, how it created the reverse pressure on quality and built your organization. Would you like to share one odd example?
Absolutely. Okay, the growth kept on. First time in 1991, before foreign exhibition, the good thing that happened was exhibition called Elecrama. Elecrama is our national exhibition, of which we should be proud of, the standard that it has acquired now. First time it took place in 1990 in Godrej, Bombay. So, we got an opportunity to display our products there. And the power of exhibition we realized. When you are exhibiting something in an exhibition, and when people come to you to see your product lines, you are considered as an expert, as an expert. How is it? How is that? And if you carry that product and business,